The outset, let me thank profusely the Ambedkar and Martin Luther King Study Circle. For the first time started in United States of America, in order to connect the liberation agendas of the Dalit, OBCs, Shudras, Adivasis in India, and the African Americans in American society historically. I thank the Study Circle organizers. You know, I've been so inspired by their work in this country, doing this kind of a program with a serious mobilization of activists, workers, writers, and so on, in order to discuss for a whole day what we should do in this present situation, both in India as well as in America and in the rest of the world, because you are looking at the world from American mainland. I've been observing, you know, Karthikeyan, Lakshmi, and other activists, the way they have been working for the last 3 days I've been here. It is really, really inspiring. So friends, I came here at a very difficult time. And the whole of India is going through very, very difficult time in its history of hundreds of years on the one side, particularly 72 years of independence. I've been under attack, threats, and I did not really think that at the age of 67 I would be able to come to America again and then participate in this kind of a new experiment, joining Dr. B.R. Ambedkar, who wrote our constitution, who gave us a philosophy of liberation for not just the Dalits but the productive mass, the Shudras, the backward classes and women, and the civil rights leader who got more than Ambedkar the global attention, including Nobel laureate, within 39 years and gave an impression in the world that he had a dream of seeing equality in every space of human life. Now this will impact India. This combination of Martin Luther and Ambedkar will definitely pave a new way in Indian struggles, politics, social movements, and spiritual systems, more important. Because I believe the spiritual systems are central to the social, economic, political existence and change or stagnation. In other words, the religions play a critical role. Ambedkar is a Buddhist and he wanted to change the whole of Dalit, Shudra, OBC masses and tribals who are not Hindus historically into Buddhism. And Vihara has to become the central place of socio-spiritual political revolution there. Martin Luther King operated from church. He was a pastor. And then when he began his civil rights movement, his whole evolution was rooted in the church. So, when we are talking about the problems of India today, the lynching, the threats, the question of, in the name of anti-beef, trying to convert the whole of land, whole of nation of 130 crore people into vegetarianism, which is going to literally kill population for want of food, because 60% of Indian food constitutes material food. I don't use the word non-vegetarian, it is nonsense. So we are meatarians, basically. We are beefarians, we are fisharians. So there is a Brahminic conspiracy to convert India into a vegetarian nation so that it cannot withstand the attack that comes from both China and Pakistan. There is a thinking of surrendering to neighbors now, as the nation got surrendered to the colonial forces earlier. We lost our confidence and courage in 16th, 17th, 18th, 19th centuries. And now they are driving to that edge through their policies, which are appearing to be progressive, peaceful, non-violent to the American, to the European, to the other countries, that non-vegetarianism and yoga are, but both of them are anti-national weakening systems. So we need to save this country. See, in the late 19th century, early 20th century, when we were enslaved by the British, Spanish, and part of the French colonialism, it was the British educated, the London educated nationalists who rescued us from that situation. Today, I think, given the situation that in which we are located, those who are living in that country, I have a new hope. I have a new dream, like Martin Luther King, that the Indian Americans will have to play a role to re-liberate us from the present situation. I don't call you non-resident Indians, NRIs, but I'll call you on parallel with Indian Americans as African Americans are. And you have to play an intellectual role by being in this imperial market controlling country as the globalized capitalist Britain, London City, has played by giving education to all the, most of the upper caste leaders who came to liberate back. Whether it was Mahatma Gandhi, whether it was Sardar Vallabhai Patel, or more importantly, Ambedkar himself, studied in London. Now you are in the best part of the educational world. The educational centrality shifted from London to America. And your children are here, please put them back to Indian environment and produce writers, thinkers, not merely, we were agrarian workers, most of us, our people here are high-tech workers. In Indian Dalit, such sections of Adivasis and Muslims have not come to terms with Ambedkar as of now, and that is really their problem. They'll face more problems if they don't. This religion was established by him, the Sangha system, though he did not believe in God. The second prophet who actually liberated slaves by putting his own soul and body on the cross telling his disciples that you live, I will die for the sake of future of the world, O Jesus Christ. Third, Prophet Muhammad. He liberated the women who were being just killed like birds and the desert communities which were totally unorganized, one against the other as the brutal inhuman forces. The fourth one emerged, though my friends do not agree with my coinage of him, Karl Marx. He has become a prophet of visualizing a socialism of no class and no proletariat and no bourgeoisie, but equality as a society. The modern welfareism is his contribution. It is not the bourgeoisie writer's contribution. It is Marx and Engels, but Marx is the center. The fifth prophet, from my point of view, from India, is Ambedkar. By the time he was born, on the planet, there was only one region where there were 80% population humanly untouchable. And he decided to abolish untouchability and decided to abolish caste because they are interlinked. And he saw that untouchability caste cannot be abolished unless Hinduism as a religion is completely destroyed. And it was because of him. And I come from a shepherd illiterate family. For 3,000-4,000 years we had no education. I'm a Shudra, I'm not a Dalit. But it is because of him I could become a professor and then write books like Why I Am Not a Hindu and Post-Hindu India. And this was the book taken to Supreme Court for banning, and incidentally democratic institutions saved me that Supreme Court rejected to ban the book. And the American Parliament, the Congress, passed a resolution that if Kancha Ilaiah is killed, the world will not keep quiet because he is known in the world as a writer and thinker, as an activist. And that is what democracy has done. And my parliament has not come to my rescue. It is in the wrong hands. Though Rahul Gandhi issued a statement and so on. So, we must look at what is the crisis. The crisis is Indian Hindu temple is totally politicized. And so long it was semi-politicized and semi-neutral, Congress could remain in power. Since it is totally politicized, it brought in its own ideological political force which want to establish Hindu Rashtra. Hindu state. It is the temple's role. Don't forget the fact. The Indian masjid is not politicized. They do 5 time namaz, appeal to Allah, and don't come into streets. The Indian church, a section is semi-politicized, what I call the Lutheran Church, the Protestant Church. The Catholic Church is totally depoliticized, apolitical in nature, but established English medium schools and educated Brahmin, Baniya, Kshatriyas for money in English. So their Sanskrit goddess shifted from Sanskrit to English now there. The goddess is in English and half of the goddess is in America now. Because this is their dreamland. they are not nationalists. Most of Dalits here, OBCs here, if there are hardly any Adivasi, I don't know any Adivasi you come across. OBC, Dalits, or you came to live at least a human life. But they are coming here to establish temples here. They are coming here to create caste in America too. And Americans don't understand. Occasionally Trump appears to be understanding in one tweet and in second tweet opposite. Trump is confusing himself and the world. So, the Catholic Church established best of the schools. In Delhi, there is one college called St. Stephen's. It has not educated a single Dalit OBC. This English I learned under the tree, not in St. Mary, St. Joseph, St. Stephen's. But it educated Arun Shauri, Arun Jaitley, Advani, all of the rich Brahmin Banyas in St. Stephen's only. They abuse Christ, want education in St. Mary, St. Joseph, St. Stephen's, and Catholic Christians educated them. Now the damage is being done at the global level. If they were to be in English, see, I gave a slogan, Brahmin bachche Sanskrit padu. Don't study English, it is a Jesus language. Only Jesus as God understands, Brahma never understands. Vishnu doesn't understand. Tirupati Venkana doesn't understand. Only Sanskrit. But you want that language. Brahmin bachche Sanskrit padu, Bahujan bachche English padu. All Bahujans must read English. English is our liberational language. And every year, my birthday, coming from illiterate, learned English under the tree by reading Karl Marx's Communist Manifesto, that the workers of the world must unite. The specter of communism is haunting Europe, really took me away with that. And I learned English there in that book, not in Bhagavad Gita. So, my birthday, October 5th, every year we celebrate as Indian English Day. And Ambedkar gave us English, not in the Christian church. So, Catholic Church, we have an engaging problem with them. They coordinate with the right wing there. So, we want to... The Buddhist Vihara did not come up to the level that Ambedkar visualized. Unfortunately, he died within few months after he became Buddhist. And the Vihara has no school and no hospital attached to them. And they have not taken up to English medium as Indian. Our slogan is, English is Indian. Sanskrit has no roots in India now. English is Indian. My observation is average labor in the agrarian field, women, men know at least 150 English words. Water, glass, bus, ticket, everything English. So English is Indian, and Ambedkar wrote in that language. So they have now owned it and they don't want to teach us. Democracy, private sector, English medium, government sector, regional languages. And unfortunately we have almost 35 languages. Once we educated in one language, we can't speak to other region. So we are completely shut there. So, church, Catholic Church, has done that damage of not teaching us English, but the Protestant church is doing some good job. In the rural areas, tribal areas, therefore they are facing huge persecutions now. So the right to religion has become a major problem now in India. Sikhs have their their own religion, they are politicized, they have a religious party, they rule themselves. They are all over here. It is in this context, what are we supposed to do? My theoretical proposition is, if religion is not democratic, society cannot become democratic. What I call spiritual democracy. If there is no spiritual democracy at the base of society, which existed for almost 2,600 years in the world as an organized institution from the days of Gautam Buddha to present. Religion is reasserting now all over the world, the right. So, four religions operate in India, and in my post-Hindu India, I characterize them like this. Buddhism is spiritual democracy without God concept. Christianity is spiritual democracy with God concept. It was that which said God created all human beings equal. That is the first spiritual democratic statement that came from God itself. Islam is a spiritual democratic religion with the same intent of the biblical continuation of the prophets, but in practice it hangs between spiritual authoritarianism and democracy, where political democracies are not surviving in Islamic countries. Where spiritual democracy is strong, political democracy is surviving. Roots. Now, Hinduism is spiritual fascism. Now, where do I get this definition? Fascism is one which does not want change as it came to the early birth. Early birth. So, in Hinduism, it is said in Rig Veda, God created people unequal. The Brahmins from head, Kshatriyas from shoulders, Shudras, Vaishyas from thighs, Shudras from feet. So the feet bone cannot go towards head. The head bone has no head at all. Head bone's head is not working. Because if people are born from head, Mahatma Phule said, heads do not work. People must be born from the mother's womb, then only head works. This was Mahatma Phule's theory. So the four division is textually unchangeable and practically unchangeable. Therefore, Ambedkar said, you have to dismantle this whole structure, even from the text. Quran has a reinterpretative ability, but they are not doing it. Reformation is less and less. When Ambedkar chose alternative religion, he examined all three religions. And he said, Islam is not reforming here, and my people may not get liberation soon. And it is not politicized enough to change societies. He said, Christianity is definitely an option, because Jesus and Buddha were the greatest figures I admire and love and appreciate. But Christianity is not politicized, therefore we can't fight for reservation from them. So he chose Buddhism. So it is in this structural problem, exceptionally what happened, we accepted democracy because the British imposed it, and the lower caste, because of Ambedkar, for one person, one vote, one value, we accepted it, and we are the ones who are keeping democracy surviving. They are not interested in democracy. They will change it. Because their Varna Dharma order should be re-restored. Hindu state means Varna Dharma order. Now this is where Martin Luther's experiment and struggle come to our help in a different way. He organized the blacks into civil rights force and women. And he unfortunately, because the Hindu structure did not allow Ambedkar to become an international figure, he doesn't know Ambedkar, and they introduced Gandhi to him. You know, if you read my autobiography, there are two chapters you must read. One is a chapter called Getting Free from Saraswati. If we Shudras, Dalits, OBCs don't get free from Saraswati, we don't get English education. Second one is My Experiments with Untruth. Gandhi autobiography is My Experiments with. And in that book he said, I ate one day goat meat, and in the night, the goat reassembled in stomach started crying. That is the truth the nation believed. I said, by 18th year in which he ate goat, I ate at least 18 goats. No goat cried in my stomach. Its blood became part of my blood. Flesh became part of my flesh. Its brain became part of my brain. Therefore, my brain is working. So this mischievous truths, what is truth is made untruth in India. And it was portrayed as religious truth. Gandhi said, when his friend asked, Muslim friend, you must eat meat in order to become strong. He said, I am a Hindu, Hindus don't eat meat. Now look at BJP. BJP says, all Hindus, Indians are Hindus, except Muslims and Christians. And they are vegetarians. Absolutely false. 99% Shudras, Dalit, OBCs, without meat, they cannot survive. So, truth is untruth, untruth is truth there. And Martin Luther shown a way out to fight. He chose non-violent. There was a debate within organization that black power we should fight for. Martin Luther said, no, once you use the word power, the whites think that we will overthrow them. They will not accept, they will not come with us. He said, the black equality should be our slogan. So we are trying to mediate the whole argument based on Ambedkar, Pule, and then now we will take Martin Luther also. And we have to politicize our church. And here is this man. He has to do that. And tell you. So, they may not trust me. In each religion, does not trust the other. And you are representing another school. And unless the Indian Muslim don't take up reform, BJP will tell them that we are reforming you. We will abolish triple talaq. Women are with us. You are not accepting. Are they could have abolished triple talaq long time back in their law society. Now they are claiming it. So this is the situation in which we are located, and I'm glad. But don't think that you have come to this American capitalist globalization market imperialist heaven. And you can eat well and drive your big cars. And as Dalits, OBCs, you may be in America, whether you believe or not, according to Hinduism, Islam, Christianity, after death, we have to go to heaven, Swarga. And for you, if you are a Dalit, OBC, Adivasi, Shudra, heaven is not available there. Brahmin is sitting there to stop you. Heaven is not available. How many temples you go here? Heaven, you are not a priest. Your son cannot become priest. There is one Venkaya Naidu who is a Sudra. I told our TV channel, let him go to Tirupati 100 times. Unless his own caste person becomes a priest there is no entry to him in heaven at all. Arun Jaitley will sit in Brahmin heaven, he will not allow him there. He has already gone there. So the question is, don't think that spiritual ideology will not come in the way and will not influence society. So let us, as Indians, as Dalit, OBC, Adivasi women, now I'm so glad women are so active, Lakshmi and others, whether Dalit or not, all women in India are Shudras. All women. And when Lakshmi told I am non-Dalit, I am so happy that a Shudra, you may be born in Brahmin family or whatever family, you are with us. Your menstrual blood is untouchable. Your childbirth is untouchable. Your body becomes untouchable for many years. Once the Dalit Bahujan state comes, everything becomes touchable. Belief becomes our ultimate food. Because this is not the way. In my autobiography, there is a song called Beef Anthem, written by a Dalit boy called Nalin. He says, beef is the secret of our energy. And we are like a black lotus, shining like a black sun. And what did the beef do? Then he goes to history. Gautam Buddha, Karl Marx, Gautam Buddha, Jesus Christ, Muhammad, Ambedkar, Karl Marx, Einstein, Martin Luther, Malcolm X, then Bob Marlin and Bob Dylan, Michael Jackson, all are Einstein, all are beef eaters, therefore they produce world-class science and technology. Vegetarians have not produced this in influence. So lastly, friends, I'll tell this story of mine, which there is a chapter in my book. My name is Ilaiah, I-L-A-I-A-H. It is humiliated, insulted. I thought of committing suicide with that name in the university. Nobody was respecting me. Lower caste. And with this face of all smallpox. And I'm lean and lanky and not very strong because I didn't eat good food in my childhood. So either I should change my name or I should commit suicide, only two options. But one day, I was searching for a book of Karl Marx in the library. Usmania University had a big library on the hilltop. You must go whenever you see. And down, underground, we have a huge library. I used to go and read there. So suddenly I saw a book from distance, Isaiah Berlin. And from a distance I read as if it is Ilaiah Berlin. Hey, my name on a book in the library. And then I went and picked it up. So what exact spelling? I-L-A-I-A-H is my name. I-S-A-I-A-H is his name. Then in the introduction it is said, Isaiah Berlin is the greatest living philosopher of the world. Then I thought, Ilaiah Kancha should become like him. And then I thought, is there a Sharma, greatest philosopher of living world? Or Shastri, or Banerjee, Chatterjee, Mukherjee? There is one Chatterjee called, he wrote something for your book, Partha Chatterjee. And all Bengalis left Bengal to the dogs, came here. All communist intellectuals. They left English, for them Bengali. Nationalism. Our nationalism is eat everything which is not poison like China. And not allow China to occupy an inch of land. And not allow Pakistan, because we built that nation. Brahmin Baniyas did not work. They were anti-production all through the history. So we built the nation by shepherding, by tilling the land, by breaking the stones, by cutting the trees, by building the temples, building the civilization. Harappa built the first civilization city. Harappa is my great, great grandfather, like for Europeans, Americans, Abraham was their ancestor. We are Harappans, not Vedic people. We are producers, and production and knowledge production will go hand in hand. That is, Europe, America respects dignity of labor. But in India, a Brahmin says, you are touching soil? No, child will spoil. You should not produce, but you should consume all that others produced. This is the greatest violence. If you eat others' production and labor, source of life is greatest violence. You bloody tell us that we are not cutting the crop, therefore non-violent. But who should cut? We are cutting the crop. And we grow hundreds, thousands of cattle and eat only tens. If we don't eat tens, we don't grow hundreds. Where is the need? So Brahminism does not understand anything. It has no brain at all. Brainless school is that Brahminism. You educate in Harvard, Oxford, Cambridge, you eat here brief, come back to India and become vegetarian. Nonsense. Therefore, my slogan now for my people in Indian universities is, you must get all the jobs, reserved and unreserved, no job in Indian universities for a foreign degree. Let us see who will become great nationalists. Let BJP say that. No foreign degree fellow. Now, Suraj may not come here. Suraj, live here. If you are foreign PhD, but you can say that I am from South Africa. Not from America. So, but this nationalism has destroyed us. We are more nationalists than them. We are producers of the nation. We are builders of the nation. We build villages, cities, towns, and we make the bricks. We produce animal economy. And buffalo is our national animal, but not cow. My last point is, 70% of Indian milk comes from buffalo. America does not produce milk from buffalo. Europe does not produce. There's no buffalo here. The whites did not understand the value of buffalo, black buffalo. They killed it. But we black people in Harappa days domesticated buffalo, converted into a milk producing animal, and they said it is a black animal, therefore omanas. Then we said black is more beautiful than white. And buffalo is our animal, then they are such stupid. If black on buffalo body is ominous, bad, ugly, when your hair become white, why do you paint it black? Such contradiction, nonsense. Your hair should be black to be beautiful. If a white girl, suppose as white as Anu is, with a white hair, will she get married in India? White hair, white girl. No, she should have very black hair. Without dowry, she can get married. The question is, Brahminism has put everything upside down. So my point is, that is the reason why I wrote that book, Buffalo Nationalism. We are buffalo nationalists, not cow nationalists. And lastly, dignity of labor should be strong lessons in universities and schools and colleges. Making the shoe, tilling the land, sweeping the house, dishwashing, everything must be trained in the schools for boys and girls. We are the most patriarchal society on earth. And Islam is very patriarchal. You have to change that through dignity of labor for men and women. And I'm glad a black hero, an Asian hero, Ambedkar and Martin Luther King are put together, this black and semi-black Indians here. And we will work, we shall overcome every problem. So we shall sing that song. We shall overcome. Thank you.
Come here to attend and support the group from LA. I have a question Thank you. My question is around with the Dr. King and Dr. Ambedkar's collaboration here. We clearly know when an American says that I'm an African American, we clearly know that their path, their life experience is totally different. But do we, how do we as Dalit Indians introduce ourselves? Because right now all Americans see us in the grand scope of Indians. We don't have a specific identity to share. I'm a writer myself, so if I go to a writer's group and sit around, they say, yeah, we have an Indian, we have an Asian person, we have an African person. So there's our diversity. But we are not able to show to Americans and others that while you have an Indian in the group, we actually don't have all parties within India. A Dalit Indian is different from just having an Indian. So how do we go about building that identity here where when we introduce ourselves to Americans, we can say, I am a Dalit Indian, and quickly put into their mind that that means that my life experience is completely different than an other Indian, an upper caste Indian who you have met. So please consider my experience, my intersectionality of race, religion, caste, and if it's a gender too, that does play. So that's my question. How do we build our Dalit identity here in the US?
Well, you know, one major problem with caste and untouchability is that for foreigners, Euro-Americans, it is very difficult to understand what is untouchability, how do they know that persons belong to that untouchability background. And how does caste operate? In fact, in 2007, when we tried to see that one Hollywood film at least is made on caste and untouchability, we spoke to directors in Los Angeles, producers, writers. They said, you know, it's very difficult to understand this problem because black and white we can really understand. And segregation we could understand. We could make films on that. A lot of novels have come, Uncle Tom's Cab, and since then several writings have come. And the blacks have produced world-class writers. The Dalits and backwards and Shudras have not produced writers at all. So, identity is an issue that you define yourself, at least this word Dalit, once it is formulated, first it was nationalized. Earlier caste were local. You know, in Tamil Nadu, Paraya and Pulaya, and Andhra Pradesh, Mala, Madiga, and then Mahar and Matang, and so on and so forth. But the Dalit word gave them an all India visibility. It was in 2001 when this issue was taken to Durban International UN conference, the world came to know about it. And now there is a lot of campaign. People hear whether the Dalits, non-Dalits, and women, they all try to use this word for identity structure. So my view is that America should produce Indian writers. The Brahmins are producing some writers. Jhumpa Lahiri, or Amitabh Ghosh, or many others are coming for market and making money. But there are no Dalit, Shudra, OBC writers. So the concept of Shudra, for example, is not known. But it's a 5,000 years old concept. We should... So only writing and propaganda creates an identity and then it establishes. Now UN is trying to grapple with caste and untouchability. BJP government does not want it to be internationalized. We are all Hindus, we should not talk about caste. There you should ask in America also, yes, there is a Hindu temple. You have a son, Siddhartha has a son. They are defining him as Hindu. If my son studies Sanskrit, okay, that God understands only Sanskrit. Fine. If my son studies Sanskrit, can he become a priest there? Why are you importing only Brahmin priests? So that is the identity question. So the only way is complex things are made easy through writing and communicable to people who do not know about it. That is what theory, novel, stories, and film. I hope Siddharth one day produces a film from here, What is Dalit Identity to the World. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other questions? Please say your name.
Hello, sir. I'm Sheikh Suleiman. I have a question.
Thank you, louder.
My name is Sheikh Suleiman. I have a question. You say that RSS is trying to enforce Varna Dharma, Dharma again. Then how do, I'm observing that many people are joining RSS from many castes. So how do they manage to attract all people? And what's going on?
See, the study circle in its pamphlet quoted a famous statement from Paulo Freire. The statement says that if you inject inferiority, superiority, the internalization of your inferiority, non-existence, become part of your brain. And the Brahmin hegemony became part of the consciousness of Dalits, OBCs, and all Shudras. They naturally think they are gods on the earth. Therefore, they have the right to become priests. So therefore, first we need to educate. See, the atrocities on Dalits are being committed by Shudras, by and large. I mean, even OBCs also. So I, having come from that, my main job is how to educate Shudras that you have no right in Hinduism as equals. You can't become a priest. You can't become a philosopher. See, I am in 21st century. The first Shudra autobiography is mine. And what is the percentage of Shudras? Merely 57% of Indian people are Shudras. 57. So no nationalist leader wrote his own autobiography thinking that what is there in my life to write? I am a Shudra. Sardar Patel also thought like that. No, tilling land, what is this? But the Brahmins wrote books after books. Gandhi also wrote, we are Gandhis, the grocers, the business class. I said, this business is social smuggling. This Brahminism is spiritual fascism. And we are shepherds. And we are greater than yours. But that assertion is not part of our brain. So therefore, again writing. From Shudra background, from women, go on producing material. Quantity produces quality. Go on producing tons and tons of books. Then a day will come, an outstanding writer, a noble laureate will come from among you, from here. Not like Amartya Sen, who begs noble laureates, this thing with collaboration with West. All come settle here, work under somebody, plan conspiracy to join with the noble laureate team, get it. Not original, not sitting in India. If you are in India, you won't get a noble laureate. Except Rabindranath Tagore, really the imperialists gave them. See, this is not the way. We have to really do original work. And that is possible.
Thank you. We are running low on time. Any question for the last question?
Last question.
Hi, thank you for your speech. My name is Akshaya. First of all, thank you for your speech. I actually had a question about something that I've noticed both in trying to break down racism as well as breaking down casteism. There's this... So something that a philosophical point that is brought up a lot, especially in I come from a very like kind of saying Absubramanya Bharati and his idea that there is, you know, there is no caste. And I've noticed this, and I've noticed this parallel to this idea that, you know, I don't see race, I don't see color. And being caste blind is being race blind, as being counterproductive to actually breaking down casteism, or actually breaking down and making a more equitable society. So what do you have to say on that? How can we change the narrative and change the philosophy so that it's more easy for people to understand that you can't just pretend that caste doesn't exist?
Yeah, you are, this is a good question, and particularly looking at from women's dimension also. How do we change the narrative? Now the question is, there is a narrative established over a period of several centuries that inequality is natural. Don't forget the fact we have not chosen our caste and born into it. We have not chosen our parents and born into that family. It is an accident that each one of us were born in that particular family, and in India that particular caste, and in that particular class. Now, having been born, what Ambedkar says is, how do you die is in your hands. Birth is not in your hands, but death is in your hands. So he took Buddhism. That question applies to me. That question applies to all women of India, not just few. The question is, my ultimate goal, or your, anybody's ultimate goal, is equality. Equality of all human beings. All are equal. Whether in the spiritual domain, or political domain, social domain, economic domain. Now to reach that goal of equality, you have a pathway established by prophets at one time, thinkers at later time, nationalists at later time. And today, we have a role to play to take the society towards that equality. Every other thing is not the goal. Equality is the goal. Man and woman, all castes, all occupations. So to do this, the only way is in India, go back to Buddhism, study its literary texts, and reapply it to, then come back to modernity, read Mahatma Phule, read Ambedkar. Globally you read Karl Marx or Martin Luther King or Clara Zetkin, or many women writers have come in the feminist movement. Sumandhi Bhuvo and so on and so forth. So today I think you have a clear pathway, like the road lines. The question is, the target is equality. And there will be a lot of problems in India more than in other countries to reach that goal. So we have to work out our ways. No writer, no thinker can prescribe, like a doctor, any particular medicine for that. So let us collectively study, collectively think, collectively work and protest, fight. In the course we may die, some of us. That's what happened to Martin Luther King. Luckily, Ambedkar survived till the last breath. He died a natural death. So I hope that will happen. And I place again more responsibility on those who were born in India to Indian parents, who were educated in best schools, colleges, universities. Please come back to India, read the history in the people's life in the villages, not in the Brahmin written books. Then you can really produce a new text which will become a guide to the future. Thank you.
I don't have a question. I'm a doctor, I have a quick prescription.
Yeah.
Leave Hinduism, leave Brahmanism, become something else. you, anyone who is there who wants to have become something else, Christian, Buddhist, something else.
Hey, thank you for that.
Sir, I had three questions, but because of the time, I'll start with one. When you talked about spiritual democracy with God, I see none of the religion sees women as equals. So the religion acts as a bigger organization. Maybe all men, every religion says all men are equal, but not all humans are equal. They don't treat, they treat women as subhumans. And family also acts the same way in a political and religious level. So when you want to go out of it, they are isolated rather than organized. So what do you think is the solution for this, or any path ahead of getting organized?
Yes, this is actually a universal question, universal issue. Pre-religious society, I don't know what forms of man-woman relationship existed, but could have been an equal choice-based cohabitation and diversification. But after religions came, it is true that women is shown as a subordinate of man. And unfortunately, most of the writings, I was carefully observing Martin Luther King's, that book, the What is the Way Now? Yeah, he categorically keeps on talking about man. You know, what does man do? But actually, black struggle started with a woman. The park. Right? He never at least puts man and woman, he and she, or human being. Even Ambedkar uses that. I tried to avoid this mistake. I would always use human being or man or woman. Now, Islam, Buddhism, Christianity, I was studying, you know, Buddha's relationship to Amrapali. She was a prostitute. She was admitted into it. Jesus Christ liberated Mary Magdalene. She was a fisherwoman. And she was the one who saw his resurrection and so on. Prophet Muhammad gave Islam to his wife, who is 15 years older to him. First. But yet, women are unequal in all these things. Hinduism, no respect at all. It's a total blanket, free inequality. There is no reform. There is no prophethood. And the greatest book that wrote, which is sold all over the world. I keep asking my Hindu friends, what is the greatest book that is being sold all over the world that you wrote? You're a Brahmin Pandit. Is it Rig Veda or is it Bhagavad Gita? No, I see only in all airports, Kama Sutra. What a tragedy. Animals know how to do this. Why did you write this in 3rd century BC when Plato was writing a Republic, Aristotle was writing Politics? This is their mind. So my question is, religions need to be fought. And the Shudra women, you read my Why I'm Not a Hindu book, I said there is Dalit Bahujan patriarchy where if man beats, woman beats back. If man drinks, woman drinks. My father used to drink, my mother used to drink kallu. I used to drink lot of kallu. And if the beating is there, counter beating and going into the street shouting, this fellow is beating, I will not be there here because he is a worker in the field. Now, Islam enslaved women because they stopped them from work. So, we need to think seriously about all religious enslavement of women. You know, I must tell you this. A Muslim high-level delegation from Jamaat-e-Islami came to me. They said Ambedkar did not take Islam. and at least you think about it. I said, I will think, but I have four or five major questions. The first question is, can I pray Allah in the mosque in English? They said, no. What should I pray in? Only Arabic. I said, Quran is saying everything is Allah created. English also Allah created. Does he not understand why I should not pray? Secondly, if I become a Muslim, my prayer leading person would be a woman. Will you allow it? They said, no. Then please think about it. I will also think. This question is there before every religion. But Christianity is going through reforms. Now, a lot of Muslim Christian women are becoming pastors. They want to demand popehood for Muslim women. I think the demand should come. So I think you start a demand that all women are equal and God himself is a woman. You say that. Then let us see how it doesn't result.
Great. Thank you for that question.